The aim of the talk is to outline acute pancreatitis in the first 72 hours, the severity, the classification, or the making of diagnosis, selection of investigations or imaging, and important things about the treatment in the first 72 hours. So pancreatitis is a problem which is the seriousness of which is understood more by surgeons and physicians treating it. For the common population, they have not heard of pancreatitis. They have heard of only cancer and brain tumors. But this disease has considerable risk of mortality. And also, there is huge cost of treatment. In private setup, the cost can go into 15 lakh and 25 lakh if there is a serious necrotizing pancreatitis with the multi-organ failure. So in the first 72 hours, what is the job of the physician who is treating it? Number one is to make a certain diagnosis. Also try and establish etiology for the pancreatitis. Ascertain the severity of pancreatitis. Stratify the risk or assess prognosis in the first 72 hours. Decide which patients will need ICU care. Have effective pain management, because that is a very distressing symptom. And pain of acute pancreatitis is something which is not relieved completely in most of the patients in the first 72 hours. So severe pancreatitis, even if we give painkiller, they still continue to have pain, but it's our job to make them as comfortable as possible. The next issue is how to resuscitate these patients, what kind of fluids are given, how to nutritionally support these patients, whether we need antibiotics and which and when, and what is the role of ERCP in acute pancreatitis. So sequentially, in the next 25 minutes or so, we'll cover all these. So to diagnose acute pancreatitis, you need two out of the three of the following criteria. One is the typical clinical picture of central upper abdominal pain radiating to the back. Second is laboratory tests. And remember, for acute pancreatitis, you need amylase, lipase to be more than 3 times normal. Now, amylase goes up sooner than lipase. So if the patient has come to you on the third day, the amylase may not be 3 times upper limit of normal. So if the patient has come 3 days after onset, then you may need lipase to confirm your diagnosis. But most of the patients, we tend to do both, because the presentation of patients is variable. Sometimes patients come within 12 hours, sometimes the patients come on the fourth day. And the patient should have imaging criteria, either interstitial or edematous pancreatitis or necrosis on either CT, MRI, or even ultrasound saying bulky pancreas, peripancreatic fluid. So two out of the three are necessary to make a confirmed diagnosis. Now, what is the differential diagnosis of severe upper or central abdominal pain, and the patient may or may not be hemodynamically unstable? So basically, we are looking for acute cholecystitis or cholangitis. In some patients, cholangitis may coexist with pancreatitis. We will come to that later. Intestinal perforation, especially if there is rebound tenderness or rigidity, which is often seen in patients with severe acute pancreatitis. Bowel obstruction may also come with upper mid abdominal pain and vomiting, and bowel ischemia infarction. Now, in many patients, the diagnosis will be certain based on clinical examination, initial ultrasound, and the amylase lipase. And that is why CT is not done on the first day in most patients. We will come to when is the ideal timing of CT later on in the talk. But unless there is serious doubt about clinical diagnosis of acute pancreatitis and you are strongly suspecting either a perforation or bowel infarction, CT is not done on admission. Coming to the etiology of acute pancreatitis, now 90% of the acute pancreatitis is either alcohol-related or gallstones. Now, third, I have put post-ERCP because in tertiary referral centers, there are more ERCPs done. And as compared to hyperglycemia, hypercalcemia, or hypertriglyceridemia, we see more patients with post-ERCP pancreatitis. So alcohol, gallstones, post-ERCP pancreatitis may constitute around 90-95% of the causes. But we must also look for hypercalcemia. Many patients of hyperparathyroidism come as acute pancreatitis. We have seen patients with triglycerides of 1,500, young patients coming with pancreatitis, because these are all treatable causes and effective medication may prevent another attack in future. So some medications, certain medications can cause pancreatitis. Medication like azathioprine can cause it. Malignancy may trigger the first attack of pancreatitis. So in a patient with first attack of pancreatitis and recent onset diabetes, we always suspect whether there is a pancreatic tumor which has precipitated it. In addition, there are other causes like trauma, developmental anomalies, which will be evident on imaging, or genetic, which generally comes as recurrent acute. So all these etiologies are kept in mind and tests are done accordingly. So on admission, what all tests do we do? We do amylase lipase, we do a blood count, liver function test, basically for biliary pancreatitis. We check the blood urea nitrogen, creatinine. And now remember, this blood urea nitrogen will come repeatedly. It will be mentioned repeatedly in acute pancreatitis because it has certain prognostic importance. It indicates the level of hydration. And if you have high BUN, it is a risk factor for severe pancreatitis. If you are giving IV fluid and BUN is not coming down, it means the resuscitation is inadequate. So we check calcium triglyceride for the etiology, C-reactive and procalcitonin again for severity of pancreatitis. Now, even if all of you feel that procalcitonin is a marker of sepsis, on first day of pancreatitis, procalcitonin is also marker of having necrotizing pancreatitis. So high procalcitonin on day one may indicate pancreatic necrosis and need not necessarily indicate there is sepsis. So we do ultrasound of most of the patients, CT, unless it is absolutely necessary to exclude other causes. MRI, MRCP generally done for biliary pancreatitis in the first few days. Endoscopic ultrasound again for biliary pancreatitis. And later on, it may be done. We are speaking about 72 hours, first 72 hours. EUS has important role later on in drainage of pancreatic fluid collections or pseudocysts. X-ray chest and abdomen X-ray is again done in all patients. So now we come to the revised Atlanta. Now, if any one of you has read the original Atlanta, which I think came in 1998, the revision started in 2008, and there were many online debates, and finally they published the statement in 2012. So the initial Atlanta, pancreatitis was divided only into mild pancreatitis and severe pancreatitis. And before first Atlanta, there was no classification separately of necrotizing acute pancreatitis. That time it was clinically mild or clinically severe. So Atlanta for the first time said that interstitial or edematous pancreatitis, where there is inflammation of pancreatic parenchyma, peripancreatic tissue, but no necrosis on imaging, versus necrotizing where there is necrosis. Now, it was important because the mortality risk of edematous pancreatitis was hardly 1% or 2%, whereas the mortality risk of necrotizing acute pancreatitis was nearly 20%. So this is the CT image. Now on CT, the parenchyma is enhanced after giving IV contrast. So in necrosis, there is no enhancement. So this is the necrotizing pancreatitis where after giving contrast, there is no, you can't see pancreatic parenchyma because most of it is necrosed. So other terminologies which were used by revised Atlanta now, earlier it used to be called peripancreatic fluid collection, and there was no separate term for walled off pancreatic necrosis. So some people used to call even walled off pancreatic necrosis as pseudosis. Now the issue is, number one, to assess the outcome of all these things. See, if you consider pseudosis and acute peripancreatic fluid collection as same, then you may feel that most of the pseudosis will resolve without doing anything. But when you classify pseudosis is only after 4 weeks, and when you have well-defined wall, then you know you can clearly see what is the difference in the natural history of acute peripancreatic collection and what is the natural history of a pseudosis. So acute peripancreatic collection happens in the setting of interstitial pancreatitis, and there is no necrosis, and this term is used when it is less than 4 weeks after the onset of pancreatitis. Okay, so many of these collections will get resolved spontaneously, but some of them may develop a wall later on and become a pseudosis. So this is a pseudosis which by definition is after 4 weeks, and it's a clear fluid inside, and it is usually outside the pancreas, because remember this happens in interstitial pancreatitis. So generally clear fluid containing pseudosis will not happen inside the pancreas. On the other hand, when there is necrosis and fluid collection, within first 4 weeks, it is called as acute necrotic collection. So when there is no necrosis, it was called as acute peripancreatic fluid collection. Now it is called as acute necrotic collection, or ANC. And once 4 weeks are over and you have a collection which has some solid necrotic element and some liquefied element with a well-defined wall, then it is called as walled off pancreatic necrosis. So the revised Atlanta has basically divided into collections which are less than 4 weeks, more than 4 weeks. So less than 4 weeks, no necrosis is acute peripancreatic fluid collection. If it is necrosis, less than 4 weeks and fluid collection, it is acute necrotic collection. After 4 weeks, if it's a clear collection, no necrosis, it is called as pseudocyst. And after 4 weeks, if there is necrosis and fluid, it is called as walled off pancreatic necrosis. Now, in the initial Atlanta, there were only two classes. One was mild acute pancreatitis, one was severe acute pancreatitis. And it was defined as, severe was defined as presence of organ failure. Now, later on, everyone realized that some centers are saying that in my severe pancreatitis, my patient survival is 95%, so only 5% mortality. Whereas another center used to say that our survival is 80%, so 20% mortality. And everyone wondered why there is a big difference in the mortality reported. So then they analyzed the data, and then they realized that even if there is organ failure necessary for severe acute pancreatitis, if it is a transient organ failure, that means there is a hypotension on day one and respiratory distress, but as you resuscitate the patient, within 48 hours, it is disappearing. So those patients are going to do well, as compared to a patient where hypotension persists beyond 48 hours, or those who continue to worsen as far as respiration is concerned beyond 48 hours. So on day one, both have two organ failure, but in one, both organ failures have resolved within 48 hours. So that's why this new term of moderately severe acute pancreatitis came. So this is a distinct subgroup of patients who have severe pancreatitis. That means they have organ system failure and or local or systemic complications, but the organ failure doesn't continue beyond 48 hours. So this was a big difference between the original Atlanta and the revised Atlanta. Okay. Now, what is the definition of organ system failure? So there is something called as modified Marshall score, and we consider three organ systems. One is respiratory, one is renal, and third is cardiovascular, and there is a score. So nowadays you can all use an app rather than remembering all these scoring systems. Okay, so the difference between mild pancreatitis is mortality of say 1% reported for mild pancreatitis, and severe it's almost 30%. Now, even this mortality of 1% is more because of comorbidities in these patients. They may have underlying severe heart disease, COPD, rather than the mortality related to pancreatitis per se, because they don't have necrosis, they don't get infected necrosis, they don't need surgery, but still the 28 or 30 day mortality is 1% because of the comorbidities. Here I want to introduce a concept which is called as SIRS, and most of the residents will know it. It is called as systemic inflammatory response syndrome. And this is very, very important in acute pancreatitis. So SIRS is defined by presence of two or more criteria of the following. So heart rate, which is more than 90, temperature, which is either low, hypothermia, patients in shock may be hypothermic, or more than 38, WBC less than 4 or more than 12, respiration more than 20, or there is PCO2 washout because of tachypnea. Now SIRS was basically defined for sepsis, but it is used for pancreatitis to assess the prognosis. So a patient who has persistent SIRS more than 48 hours is likely to get multi-organ failure and more likely to die. So mortality of 25% if there is persistent SIRS, and 8% for those who have only transient SIRS. So, and if you see this slide, it is very easy to check for SIRS. So you don't need any fancy laboratory test, Apache score, nothing is necessary. So SIRS is very important to evaluate the patient on a daily basis. Okay, so SIRS is basically a cytokine storm which is impacting, although the cytokines are released by pancreas, it tends to impact function of other organ systems, and it may give rise to organ failure. So if we see in this diagram, the cytokine production is maximum in the first say 24 to 36 hours, and maximum organ dysfunction happens at anywhere between 3 days to 5 days. So the concept is that if you handle these patients well in the first 3 to 5 days, the risk of having persistent organ failure or progressive organ failure is less. So the issue is, can we predict the storm? So which patients, suppose you see the patient on admission in the casualty, so which patients are likely to have a very stormy course of pancreatitis? And here it is important to know that severity of pain of pancreatitis has nothing to do with severity of actual cytokine storm. So patient may have severe pain, but patient may have only mild interstitial pancreatitis. Okay, so severity of pain has nothing to do with severity or prognosis of acute pancreatitis. So there are many clinical scoring systems. If you see, SIRS is what we have seen already. And there is PANC3, BISAP, which includes BUN, impaired mental status, SIRS, age plurus. So you will find that repeatedly people have checked hematocrit, people have checked blood urea nitrogen, because both are markers of hemoconcentration or hypovolemia. So in patients who have third spacing, fluid losses, the BUN will be high, hematocrit will go up. Now, what happens when the hematocrit goes up is there is increased viscosity of the blood. So the pancreatic microcirculation is affected, which worsens the necrosis in acute pancreatitis. And that is why hematocrit is given great importance in acute pancreatitis. But otherwise, base deficit again reflects perfusion of different organs. PaO2 is a reflection of respiratory function. So in different systems, similar pattern will come. There'll be BUN, there'll be oxygen, there'll be hematocrit. So now the question for everybody is, you know, should we remember all of this? Absolutely not. Now, what is important here is the second system, which is called as HAPS or harmless acute pancreatitis score. This is a very, very interesting study where if on admission, there is no abdominal tenderness, the hematocrit is normal and the creatinine is normal, you can predict with 99% accuracy that this patient is unlikely to have any necrotizing pancreatitis. So these patients can be, you know, started on orals as soon as possible and discharged from the hospital as soon as possible. Okay, so that is called as harmless acute pancreatitis score. But otherwise, your textbooks will give you all Ranson score, Glasgow-Emery score, Apache. But it is not necessary to remember all this because nowadays, most of the apps, you can calculate scores of all these. Okay. So how do we clinically assess? So age more than 55 years, obesity is considered a very, very major risk factor for prognosis in acute pancreatitis. Now, this has been recognized in the last 10, 12 years. So age more than 55, BMI more than 30, altered mental status, comorbid disease. So these are the patient characteristics, baseline. Then comes SIRS, which we have seen earlier, two or more of the, you know, temperature and pulse and respiration and WBC count. Then you have laboratory findings. As I said, BUN, which is elevated or rising, is a poor prognostic indicator. Hematocrit more than 44% or rising hematocrit in spite of giving fluids. Elevated creatinine, elevated CRP, elevated PCT. But the bottom line is none of these are clearly superior or inferior to persistent SIRS. And like I said, SIRS is very easily calculated bedside. You only need a WBC count for that. But temperature, pulse, respiration can be easily checked. Now, apart from clinical indicators, there are certain CT severity indicators also. Now, initial was given by Balthazar. I think it was in 1999 and it was modified later in 2004. So, most of the CT scans done for acute pancreatitis, you will find that the report will contain modified CT severity index. And again, you can classify patients into mild or severe. Now, coming to deciding which patient needs ICU. So, those who have cardiorespiratory instability, Apache 2 score more than 8 in the first 24 hours, persistent SIRS, like I said, elevated hematocrit, BUN more than 20, creat more than 1.8, again, which means that there is severe hypoperfusion, age more than 60 years, and underlying cardiac or pulmonary disease or obesity. So those who have pre-morbid obesity or pre-morbid ischemic heart disease, they are better managed in ICU. So we come to the now, we have covered almost 75% of the talk. We come to what is management of pancreatitis in first 72 hours. And here, I would like to show you a very famous painting. This painting is by J.M.W. Turner, painted in 1826. So the title of the painting is Steamboat off a Harbor's Mouth. Now, if anybody has seen a movie on this painter, I think it's there on Netflix. The movie is called Turner. Now, J.M.W. Turner had actually tied himself to mast of a ship, basically to experience the storm. And this is something that he saw before he painted. You can see the boat, but there is just excess of, you know, water, snow. There is smoke from the ship because these used to be steamboats. Now, surprisingly, Turner had painted a series of paintings which are depicting storms, ships in storms. And what is important for us to remember, the lesson that we get from this is due to the massive cytokine storm in acute pancreatitis, the patient is like a ship in a storm. Now, what does the physician do in a storm like this? So what does a captain of the ship do? He never tries to get the ship to the coastline. His job is just to maintain the ship in position and not allow it to sink. Okay, so the physician who is treating acute pancreatitis should remember that his job is not to cure the patient in first three to five days. Job is to just stabilize the patient. Okay, so the principle is maintain tissue hydration, maintain tissue nutrition, and maintain tissue oxygenation. This is a very, very simple intensive care principle. Tissue nutrition, tissue hydration, and tissue oxygenation. Okay, so in fluids, it has been found that Ringer lactate works better than normal saline. There are some studies which say that the SIRS response decreases with Ringer lactate more than it decreases with normal saline if you give same amount of fluid to patients. Hydroxyethyl starch is avoided because it tends to worsen SIRS and organ failure. Now there is slight change in the guidelines. This slide will tell you. 2013 ACG guideline, they mentioned a very aggressive fluid regimen, 500 cc per hour, which will go on for 10 hours, 12 hours, which was massive amount of fluid infusion. They had said Ringer lactate is better over normal saline. But in 2018, just see the recommendation has changed. They are not mentioning now what should be the fluid per hour. Okay, now, why is that happened? Because if you see here, initially when the patient comes to you, the patient is hypovolemic. Patient may be hypotensive, cold, clammy skin, there may be acidosis. Now, if you overload these patients, then patients have edema, they go in respiratory distress syndrome, they get abdominal compartment syndrome just because of excessive edema. Patient may be having underlying heart disease and they may go in cardiac failure. So you want to avoid overload. At the same time, if the patients remain hypovolemic, the pancreatitis or the necrosis also worsens and the multi-organ failure also worsens. So you have to have an optimal volume infusion. And that is why that standard thing of 500 ml per hour for on day one, that means you may give 6-7 liters on day one. So that is not a blanket recommendation. So what is now said is 5 to 10 ml per kg per hour should be used until resuscitation goal. And we'll come to how to decide whether your resuscitation is sufficient. Okay. So when do you say that resuscitation is sufficient? In a patient who has say heart rate of 140 initially, the heart rate goes to less than 120, your mean arterial pressure remains between 65 to 85, urine output is more than 0.5 to 1 ml per kg per hour, hematocrit doesn't exceed 44, because as we saw earlier, hematocrit more than 44 is a high risk for poor prognosis. So hematocrit you maintain between 35 and 44. Now, CVP alone may be unreliable. So it's not that we keep on chasing the CVP, because patients who have hypoproteinemia, patients who have heart disease, it may be risky to just keeping on infusing fluid till CVP comes to say 10 or 12 or 14 or 16. So we have to go by the hemodynamics and urine output and the hematocrit. Now, what do we do for pain? Now, earlier morphine was considered the best analgesic because it is very effective, but then theoretically it causes spasm of sphincter of Oddi, which may worsen the pancreatitis, because sphincter of Oddi dysfunction is considered one cause for pancreatitis. So nowadays either meperidine, even tramadol can theoretically cause sphincter of Oddi dysfunction, but meperidine or tramadol we use along with paracetamol. Now, when do we do CT? Like I said, the ideal time for CT is at least 70 to 96 hours later. So maybe day 5, or preferably any time between 5 to 7 days. Now, when do we ask for CT on day one? This we discussed earlier. If there is diagnostic uncertainty, or you are assuming it is pancreatitis, but the patient's response is not as per your expectation. So you are thinking that something else is going on apart from just pancreatitis. So say you are suspecting gallbladder perforation along with pancreatitis, then you may do CT earlier. Now, antibiotics. So the general tendency of every doctor, especially those who are working outside tertiary referral centers, is to start at least one antibiotic. Now, often we get patients who are initially admitted in a nursing home, and generally they have received one cephalosporin, sometimes one amikacin or aminoglycoside and metronidazole. So over last 20 years, it has been very clear that intravenous antibiotics given as a prophylaxis are not necessary. There is also some data that it may not only not change the prognosis, but it may make the patient prone to getting fungal infection in that necrosis. Okay, so no antibiotics, but if the patient has severe urinary tract infection, say a diabetic patient, severe urinary tract infection, or there is cholangitis, say bilirubin is 10, SGOT, SGPT is high, patient has high swinging temperature, then yes, of course, you have to give antibiotics for proven extra pancreatic infection, but not for acute pancreatitis in the first 72 hours. Now, probiotics were given because everybody assumed that necrosis of the pancreas gets infected from the bowel bacteria, say E. coli or so. So to reduce the bowel bacterial load, there was an interesting theory of giving probiotics. The only trial which had randomized comparison of the two showed that the mortality in probiotic group was higher than the placebo group. And so current recommendation is not to give any probiotic as a standard medication. Even routine antifungal, unless you have proven fungal infection, either in blood culture or aspiration of the pancreatic necrosis. So routine antifungal is not recommended. Now, what about nutrition? Always enteral nutrition is preferred over parenteral nutrition because it maintains integrity of gut, reduces the bacterial translocation from the gut into the bloodstream. It also reduces the cost of nutritional support because enteral nutrition is far easier, less costly than parenteral nutrition. Now, in patients with mild pancreatitis, it is safe to start orals within first 48 to 72 hours. Now, in very mild pancreatitis, the recommendation is also that if you are giving low fat solid diet, you can straight away start it, but most of us will not do it. Generally, we first give liquids and see whether the patient tolerates and then only go to soft diet. Now, should we put nasogastric tube in everybody, nasojejunal tube in everybody? Now, if the patient is able to tolerate orally, nasogastric tube is not needed. But say patient is on ventilator, patient may need nasogastric feeding. If the patient is unable to tolerate nasogastric feeding, see some patients have severe edema which is compressing on the duodenum. So it becomes like gastric outlet obstruction and the patient is unable to tolerate either orals or nasogastric feed. So those who do not tolerate nasogastric feeds are candidates for nasojejunal feeding. So nasojejunal feeding is not necessary for everybody. Should we give probiotic supplement? Like we said, no. Whether there are any antioxidant supplement, glutamine necessary. So there is no clear-cut evidence that all these benefit the patient. Only important thing is start feeding as soon as possible and enteral, you know, is preferred over parenteral. Okay, in acute biliary pancreatitis, if there is elevated SGOT, SGPT, elevated bilirubin, stones in the gallbladder, mildly dilated CBD or even normal CBD, but the enzymes are elevated, we do either MRCP or EUS if available to look for choledocholithiasis. Now, what is the timing for ERCP? So only those patients who have cholangitis and CBD stone should undergo urgent ERCP within first 24 hours. So if the patient is not in cholangitis and there is a CBD stone seen, there is no urgency. You can do the ERCP in 72 hours or so. Now, why it is better or, you know, advisable to avoid ERCP in the first 24 hours? Number one, some patients are unstable because of pancreatitis, not because of the CBD stone. So we are sedating those patients. Some of them may have airway compromise. Some of them may become hypoxic, desaturate during the procedure, or the sedation may worsen the hypotension. So instead of ERCP benefiting the patient, we may worsen the outcome. And that is why, unless there is concurrent cholangitis, there is no need to do an emergency ERCP. Some patients of pancreatitis, the duodenum is so edematous that sometimes in first 24 hours, you may not see the papilla also. So forget about cannulation. There is just impossible. It is just impossible to visualize the papillary orifice. But after, if you wait for 3 days or so, the edema settles down and it is easier to do that. So just touching the abdominal compartment syndrome is, you know, even if intra-abdominal pressure elevation is seen commonly in pancreatitis patient, the true abdominal compartment syndrome is not very common. And if there is such rise in abdominal pressure that it affects the organ function, so there is renal failure developing, the cardiac output is decreasing because of poor venous return, that is the time when something needs to be done. And there are three standard, you know, ways of tackling abdominal compartment syndrome. One is to reduce the hollow viscera volume. So just stop feeding, aspirate, ensure with a suppository or an enema that the patient evacuates. If there is excessive extravascular fluid, one can consider a CRRT to take out the fluid. And very rarely, one may need, you know, some kind of surgical intervention to do that. But just relaxing the patient, giving good painkiller may also allow abdominal wall to expand further. So coming to the last slide, second last slide, this is what are the key points? Number one is we have to stratify the risk. You can use a scoring system or just use SIRS to decide which patients are at risk of getting multi-organ failure. We identify the etiology. CT is better to be done after 72 hours, preferably between day 5 and 7 to clearly see what is the extent of necrosis and the peripancreatic local complications. Now, as far as treatment is concerned, remember the ship in the storm, that our job is just to stabilize the ship. We are not expecting a cure. We are not taking the ship back to the port when we are in the midst of a storm. So adequate resuscitation. We discussed the goal-directed therapy where you go by hemodynamics and hematocrit and urine output rather than having fixed concept about how much fluid is to be given. No antibiotics in the first 72 hours unless there is documented extra-pancreatic infection. No probiotics for this patient hoping to reduce the risk of infection. Early feeding. As far as possible, enteral nutritional support rather than parenteral, and oral better than nasogastric, better than nasojejunal initially. If you can't feed orally, then go to nasogastric. If you can't feed nasogastric, go to nasojejunal. And ERCP is not for all patients with pancreatitis and definitely not as an emergency procedure in all patients with pancreatitis. So this is another painting by JMW Turner. Here the ship has come out of the storm. It is in quiet waters. And this is one of the very few paintings that Turner has done where there is a ship, but there is no storm. So all of us treating patients with pancreatitis just hope that the patient's ship sails through and you are again back in the port in quiet waters. Thank you.